Using the Laplace transform of a differential equation, you can reduce the differential equation to an algebraic equation for the transformed function. And solving the latter is much easier. So, how do we compute a Laplace transform of a function? That is what you will learn in this video. And first of all, can we do that for all functions? Well, for a lot of functions. If you have a function f from 0 infinity to r, so we only put positive values in our f, and our function f is of exponential order if f of t is bounded by some exponential function m times e to the power a t, where m and a are constants and a is positive. So your f can become really large because it only has to be below an exponentially growing function. So this m times e to the power a t can grow exponentially, so it can become really large. F is below that, but well, f can become very large itself as well. So how is our Laplace transform defined then? The Laplace transform of f of t, denoted as capital F of s. How do we compute that? Well, you take your f of t, you multiply by e to the power minus s times t and integrate from 0 to infinity, where s may be some complex number sigma plus I times tau. That's how it's defined. When can you compute this integral? Well, the norm of f times e to the power minus st, you know that your f was below some exponential function, m times e to the power at, and you can write your st as sigma times t minus I times t times tau. Well, the norm of this part is 1, of course. So you find something which is below m times e to the power a minus sigma times t. Well, when can you integrate this? Well, only if this a minus sigma is a negative number, because then the total integrand is below something which behaves like e to the power minus t, so falls off. And then you can integrate this, of course. It goes absolutely convergent if your a minus sigma is smaller than 0, so that means that your sigma has to be bigger than a, so your real part of sigma is real part of s is bigger than a. Then this integral exists. So you can compute your Laplace transform, provided your e to the power minus st is strong enough to cancel out this divergence which arises from your function f. So only if your real part of s, your sigma, is big enough. And that's what's expressed by this condition, that the real part of s has to be bigger than your a. Moreover, you can prove that your function f of s is even analytic if the real part of s is bigger than a. Let's take a look at some examples. So what will this a become, for example? First example, f of t equals e to the power a t. Obviously of exponential order, with exponent a, and the capital M is in this case 1. So what do we get for your Laplace transform? Capital F of s, so you integrate your function times e to the power minus st, so it yields e to the power a minus s times t. Integrate, so you get 1 over a minus s times e to the power a minus s times t from 0 to infinity. Well, lower boundary is no problem. Upper boundary, we have e to the power a minus s times t, where t goes to infinity, only converges if a minus s, if this limit here exists, minus lower boundary, which is no problem, of course. And this limit equals 0, provided this a minus your real part of s is smaller than 0, because then you have e to the power minus r, for r going to infinity goes to 0. So in that case, your upper limit in your integral vanishes, integral converges to 1 over s minus a. So what does this condition mean? Well, that the real part of s has to be bigger than a. So you find your capital F of s, an analytic function, 1 over s minus a, and indeed this function is analytic, provided you are to the right of your a. So what happens to derivatives? Let's do another example, the Laplace transform of f prime. What happens if you try to compute that? Well, you get your integral, but now of f prime times e to the power minus st dt. You use integration by parts. So first you integrate your f prime, that yields your f times the e to the power minus st between the boundaries, minus, you leave the f of t and differentiate e to the power minus st, so that yields minus s times e to the power minus st over there. So what do we get? Well, the s does not depend on t, so you can take it out of the integral. You can take it in front. So you get for the integral plus s times integral e to the power minus st times f of t. But that's exactly the Laplace transform of f. So integral becomes s times Laplace transform of f. So what happens in the first term? Well, if f is bounded, etc., then the upper bound over here vanishes, and the lower bound gives you the minus f of 0. So what do you get for your Laplace transform of f prime? Well, s times the Laplace transform of f, so s times f of s, minus f of 0. So in this way, you can convert Laplace transforms of derivatives into the Laplace transform of the original function, and that is how you are going to use it in solving differential equations.